Tell us what you think, in person, over the phone, online. Watch and hear yourself on TV. You tell us, we air it. This is The Local Live.
Good evening, I'm Archelle Milder, and welcome to The Local Live. As every Thursday night, we're here to keep you informed of what's happening in our communities. Here's a preview of what's coming up. What does the Charleston shooting mean for you? For our roundtable discussion this week, we'll hear how the incident has impacted our community and what we can do to fight the racism that has motivated the gunman. Look out, residents, your utility bill might go up. Stay tuned for our recap of the Village of Amerenix Board of Trustees meeting. We are following up on the parking issue in the village. More details tonight. Did you miss the LMCTV award night? Stay tuned for a look at the highlights. And let's help Fergie find a forever home. One of the main topics of discussion in last week's Village of Amerenix Board of Trustees meeting was the raising the water tax in Amerenix by 18%. The reason for this raise was the fact that Amerenix only collected approximately $1 million in water taxes in 2014. Let's look at what was said.
The cost of water from New York City, which is continuing to escalate, and to also provide for and mitigate in the future rate increases related to the capital spending that will be coming along soon.
Many of you have read in the newspaper about the water crisis in California and other parts of the country. That becomes relevant in the context of water rates and water funds.
Because past boards, which are not political, both Republican and Democratic boards, had a propensity to have water increases.
A decision has yet to be reached about the tax increase, and the issue will continue to be debated in the upcoming Board of Trustees meetings. In other village news, we have an update on the parking situation on Amerenix Avenue. After the huge backlash from residents and business owners against the new proposed parking regulations, the mayor and Board of Trustees decide to seek volunteers to serve on the Ad Hoc Parking Advisory Committee to help come up with alternative solutions. The Ad Hoc Committee will also review changes now under consideration, including a pay-by-space versus a pay-by-plate system, extended metered parking hours, charging varied meter rates by time of day or length of parking time, upgrading parking technology for parking lots, on-street parking in the wider business district. The Ad Hoc Parking Advisory Committee will include residents, business owners, and Chamber of Commerce members. Let's take a listen at a resident's inquiry regarding the parking committee.
I was wondering, how much authority will they have? For example, if they come up with 8 suggestions, will only 1 or 2 of those suggestions be adopted by the BOT?
It's an advisory board, and they would come back and make their comments to the Board of Trustees to use in their decision of how they want to go forward with the parking policies. There's okay. No, quote, power to legislate.
Right. Okay. So I suppose that the board is still going through with this, which doesn't really make sense. Number one, you've had an overwhelming and unprecedented amount of public input. Emails were sent not only by the mayor, but also by an executive member of the Democratic Committee on April 23rd, encouraging people to consider the proposed changes and share their thoughts. And people did exactly that. They came out in unprecedented numbers and offered input. Plus, you have a substantial list of recommendations suggested by a parking study. So, what else do you need? You've had the public input, you have the recommendations. What else do you need? It doesn't make sense. If you still feel like you need more input, then invite the public to share, to offer more ideas, instead of telling the public, no, we'd rather choose the group of people we're willing to listen to by forming a committee. Do you see how that makes a mockery of democracy?
Residents and business owners interested in serving on the committee should submit their resume as soon as possible to the Clerk Treasurer's office at clerktreasurer@vomny.org. And to the board, mayor and board at vomny.org. If you want to watch the full meeting, log on to www.lmctv.org. And now I'll give it over to Mike Witch to see what stories we found in the media this week.
The Mamaroneck Review reports that one of the last historic houses in Mamaroneck might be sold to developers. The Delancey Cooper House, built in the late 1700s, is the one-time home of James Fenimore Cooper. The author wrote his novel, The Spy, while living there. The Historic Society wants to preserve the house, even build a museum on the property, and they're searching for a donor. The current owners are asking $2.5 million. Read the full story in the Mamaroneck Review, and read Don Sutherland's letter in the June 20th edition of LowHUD.com. It's called, The Delancey House is Worth Saving. Also in the review, a report from a wildlife team that there's a very high deer population in Mamaroneck and Rye. Not really news, because we often see deer grazing on lawns in our area. Animal rights groups, however, are alarmed over a program that would allow the deer to be hunted. Besides killing the animals, the group says that there would be danger to innocent bystanders as well as traffic. Read the review for more information. Plans to lay a natural gas pipeline close to the Indian Point nuclear power plant is worrying residents in the neighboring communities. The pipeline, approved in March, will be only feet away from the plant. Several weeks ago, there was a fire at one of the reactors. The plant was shut down for 2 weeks. The worry is that another fire could be catastrophic if the gas pipes are nearby. The Loop has that story. 20 million people live in the area surrounding Indian Point. And finally, Swim Across America, the very successful fundraisers for cancer research. They start July 11th and they continue through August 1st. The organization has raised some $60 million over the several years it's been doing these swims. Swimmers decide how far they want to go, from 2K all the way to 10K. The Hamlet Hub has that story. And those are just a few of the local news items that caught our eye this week in the media. Thanks to our reporter-writer, Chris Pellegrini. I'm Mike Witch.
Thanks, Mike. Coming up next is our weekly trivia question, but make sure to stay tuned for our roundtable discussion, the Charleston shootings, and our community.
Shooting last week at the Emmanuel AME Church in Charleston, South Carolina, has stunned and repulsed the nation and has dominated the news cycle for the past week. Tonight, we'll be asking whether it's really an aberration and whether it could happen here. As always, we want you to join the discussion by phone, email, or tweet. Our contact information is on your screen. Now, we have a full table here tonight. We're joined by Town of Mamaroneck Councilman Tom Murphy, Mamaroneck resident and parishioner at Mamaroneck's Barry Avenue AME Zion Church, Leilani Yizer, Village of Mamaroneck Justice, Christy Derrico, and Loringo Mitchell, a longtime Mamaroneck resident, sports coach, and activist. And thank you all for being here. And I actually want to start with that first question. Could this happen here? Or is it a Southern problem or an isolated event? Tom, I'm going to start with you.
Well, not to be an alarmist, but sure, it could happen here. You know, this is an American problem. It's not just a Southern problem. You know, we saw, you know, a mass shooting in Newtown, you know, at the grammar school there, where 20 young children were killed and six teachers. This is another tragedy that's happened down south. You know, the motivation might be different, but, you know, we're in a country that's awash with guns and has a history of violence.
Well, I was really going to the racism element of it. And I just want to interrupt with a little historical tidbit. New York and Charleston share something very historically in common, which surprised me. In the colonial times, New York City's slavery population, or the number of residents with slaves, was rivaled only by that of Charleston, South Carolina.
Mm-hmm. Who knew?
Which is, who knew? Mm-hmm. So going towards the racism issue, gun control is another subject.
Well, I do think that there's racism in all parts of the country. Of course, the South has had a much more vicious history in the past 100 years, what with Jim Crow laws and the KKK. And, you know, after the Civil Rights Movement, the use of the battle flag as kind of a symbol of defiance to integration, and that we're going to support racism. So, you know, it can happen everywhere. Yes, the racism isn't just exclusive to the South. It's all over this country. You know,
Leilani, I'm going to let you join in.
I do agree with Tom. It could happen. It could happen anywhere.
Would you be as surprised that it happened here as happening in Charleston?
I wouldn't, because we have all these shootings that are happening nationwide. We're dealing with racism nationwide. So, yes, last week it was maybe in Maryland. You know, today it's in Charleston. Months ago it was in Missouri, or, you know, it's different places. So it could happen anywhere.
Hmm. Christy?
Well, I want to be hopeful that we have a more integrated community. People are friends with a variety of different type of people, and that it shouldn't be able to take a foothold here. But I can't disagree, anything can happen anywhere. But I was surprised to learn that the number of arsons committed at churches was so high that it prompted federal legislation, and that a church in Massachusetts was burned down on Obama's inauguration day. And I would think of Massachusetts as a pretty progressive state, mm-hmm. and that really surprised me.
And was that a racially biased crime?
Apparently, yes, it was a black church. And this is part of an example of a rash of these types of crimes that have happened around the country. So it seems to indicate that it isn't isolated to the southern states. But I found that disheartening, to be honest. I want to be more optimistic that we can rise above this. That's how I like to think of it.
Loringo, I'm going to let you weigh in on this, too.
I have to agree with Christy. I think when I look at our town, what we have, our makeup, the way the town is laid, I have to say that there's a view of optimism that due to our daily interactions with people, that maybe we're a little bit further past that. But any time that a person feels disenfranchised, and that's the word I'm going to use, I try to steer a little bit away. I know that racism is a very large part of what we're facing, as maybe even a mental illness of our country. But as for disenfranchised people, what we're seeing is, and to piggyback off what you're saying, when I went to school in Massachusetts, actually, there were a couple of times we came across the Confederate flag actually on people's mm-hmm. porches. So when I look at the flag, and the flag has many meanings to many different people, mm-hmm. but when I'm looking at people and disenfranchisement, not feeling a part of what we would call our country per se, these are some things that might be some ways or some different angles we could try to start to look at what's the rationale behind people's thought process in this way.
Okay. Not that long ago, well, actually almost 10 years ago, there were swastikas found in Mamaroneck.
That's correct.
And frankly, they were found again in a nearby college at SUNY Purchase a mere couple of months ago. Mm-hmm. Part of the same problem?
I was thinking of that same thing. And again, what comes to mind when I think of those acts is what my children said to me when we discussed it, which was, what jerk would do that? Mm-hmm. And to me, that means they're friends with a bunch of different kids who would be insulted and affected by that, mm-hmm. just as if something like this happened close to home, my children would be personally hurt that it could be kids they go to school with. But that was the first instance that came to mind. These are, you know, inflammatory acts trying to, as this young man said, cause a stir, cause people to fight amongst themselves.
Mm-hmm. Are any of you surprised that this level of racism still exists?
No.
I think that for a lot of folks, like to think that, you know, when the laws changed in 64 and, you know, institutional racism was kind of, you know, tamped down by the federal government. And, you know, now, you know, after Obama's election, a lot of people like to say we're in a post-racial world, but it's just not true. I can tell that from my experience as a white person, you know, talking to other white people. You know, there's a lot of people who still have racial animosity and think it's okay because you're white to say that to you. And, you know, it's disheartening and it's sad. And, you know, it's just, you know, something that I hope gets worked out through the generations as time goes on. It's obviously a lot better than, you know, when we were kids. And, you know, I hope it gets better. But to think that it's gone is, we have to have a conversation about what it is. We have to have a conversation that it exists before it can get better. You know, it's the first step is admitting we have a problem.
Oringel, I want to direct a question to you.
Of course.
And actually, you can all answer it, but I want to get you more in the conversation,
yes,
which
ma'am.
Is, do you think racism, the level of racism, is yes, better, worse, or the same since having an African-American or biracial president?
Oh, that's a tough one. I don't think you could, just because of an election, we can talk about the hearts of people changing. You know, piggybacking off what Tom was saying, the striking down of the Voting Rights Act and the changing of the laws there is a way of, for people looking at that the things have possibly changed. But as we've seen, some people's hearts and minds haven't. And I think it might have made things worse because we might have become complacent in regard to some of the real issues that still face us as a nation, as a problem. And I think, again, striking down on that Voting Rights Act is a big deal because it changes the complexion of our voting and our power structure. And to answer your question, I think it might have made us a little bit more complacent in regards to working out situations.
Is there a chance that it also rallied those who might be racist?
Yeah, I think that I think visually for mm-hmm. me, because growing up in a different generation, I wasn't here in 64, but I think it's more visually seen.
By the way, we were
Obama.
Really, really young. Not really aware.
Well, I just wasn't born. But I really do, I think for me, it's more visual. Like, you know, you hear about the KKK, you hear about hate groups and everything else, but now it's just more visually. People are being killed. You actually see on the news or hear that, like you said, churches are being burned or, there's still people feeling the racism towards them, you know, the hate groups and the bashing of others. So I think it's more visual.
Well, isn't it all hate? I mean, when we really look at the people who are the perpetrators, these are deeply unsettled, evil people. Mm-hmm. I mean, we can all agree on that. Mm-hmm. So anything where you have so much energy to hate someone else, I mean, it has to be eradicated.
Okay, so that actually leads right into the next question, which is how? How do we eradicate racism? What should people do?
The education, you know, the lack of education and conversations. This is a great panel for, you know, this is a great way to educate people, is just having these discussions. All races, all ages, it's just to have a conversation.
About racism about or about racism, other things?
About racism, about other things, about learning about others' history and how we got to this state. It's education plays a huge part.
There's no question. I was a history major, and I read a book this past year, The Invention of Wings by Sue Monk Kidd, who actually, it focuses on Charleston and Denmark Vesey is one of the characters. It's faction, you know, historical fiction.
Right.
Okay. But the point in saying this to you is, I was in upstate New York after reading this, and I thought people walked from Charleston through upstate New York to get to Canada to escape the torture that they were going through, and I didn't visualize. You study it in school,
of course,
but it's not till somebody makes a character that you can identify with that maybe kids, if they read this book, will say, that's really evil, that's really terrible that someone could do that to another person. But to think they were coming from a warm southern climate and they walked all the way up to freezing cold Canada without something, probably any clothes on, or sometimes maybe no shoes, who knows? It really brought it home for me, and it was amazing that this actually was the church that Denmark Vesey founded.
Right.
It was the anniversary of that revolt that this young man picked, so he knew what it was.
I think in the schools, our history in terms of black people is not enough information on it.
Really?
In terms of books that we have to read, and I know when I was in school, I learned more about my culture when I went down south to Bennett College. Mm-hmm. And that's when I learned more about me, who I was. And then not just even, I mean, I learned a lot from my family. But I didn't get enough, and you know, in my, I guess, elementary, middle school, high school years.
I think that's a key point. But I also want to play a little bit of a devil's advocate, and I do that well. we look at, you know, my family's from Beaufort. And as we were leaving my grandmother's gravesite, I said to my sister, she's an educator, I said, Juanita, how does a person teach history? I'm a political science undergrad. How does a person in the South teach mm-hmm. history? No one wants to teach that I've lost. No one wants to make a mockery of their family. You know, your family unit is what you know. Whether you agree with it or not, we all have parts of our family that we agree with, we don't. And I think you see some of that with the Battle of the Flag. It's a part of us all together. Unfortunately, it's a negative part for some, but for some, they're not looking at it that way, and they're hanging on to it. And not like not to say I'm gonna agree with it now, but we're talking about ways we can change things, ways we can change minds, mm-hmm. ways that we can across the board have a conversation about this. I said, you gotta have a monologue with yourself mm-hmm. about truth, about justice, about what's right first. Then you can have a conversation because now you can open yourself. Mm-hmm. But right now, the dialogues that are happening, they're fabricated, they're not real, mm-hmm. right. okay? They're tainted from the beginning. So how can we really have a true a dialogue if the monologue is coming from a tainted angle from the beginning?
But how can you start that?
I mean, within your family. If you're not willing to talk about it at your own dinner table, mm-hmm. you know,
well,
or even like
point.
Lolo said, if you're not even able to deal with it,
yes,
oh, shoot.
That's Laringo.
That's fine.
Many people would not know me. That's fine. That's fine. It's fine.
What happened to your face?
What he said, you know, I'm a true believer that it definitely starts within. If you don't know yourself, if you can't vocalize to yourself who you are and what you are and what you believe, then it's hard to even come out to somebody else. Because if you do come out to somebody else, you're lying about it.
Yeah.
You're not really.
And that applies to lots of different things.
Different things. But in terms of racism, if you can't really, I'm sorry,
no,
Tom.
If
you can't really state like how you truly feel about races, mm-hmm. you know, it's hard.
You know, I had an interesting conversation a few months ago. I work in a building. I'm the elevator mechanic. And most of the guards are African-American men, probably between 28 and 35. Mm-hmm. They all have full-time jobs. Mm-hmm. They all live in the outer boroughs of the city.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And I started talking to these guys, and we started talking about stop and frisk.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And a lot of these guys had been stopped 30, 35 times.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And it was hard for me to, like, grasp. I mean, mm-hmm. I've been stopped a couple of times by the police when I was younger, mm-hmm. and it's an interesting and hard experience. Even when you're treated nicely.
Yes.
But these guys have to deal with that day in and day out, and they have kind of like a survivor's joking about it. But I realize, you know, this has to be really, you know,
well, let
debilitating.
I am going to interject here that I have children who have been subjected to stop and frisk on multiple mm-hmm. occasions.
Mm-hmm.
So,
mm-hmm.
it is, you know,
but
I understand it is not daily.
It's also in terms of when they stop and frisk, how they're stopping
and
frisk, what happens during the stop and frisk.
That makes a huge difference.
It's a huge difference. Yeah. It's not as simple sometimes.
That's right. Mm-hmm. And I've wondered if my kid had not complied,
mm-hmm.
put your hand on the police officer puts a hand on the wrong kid in the wrong mood.
Mm-hmm. Just let me interject a quick story. I was 26 years old. It was 1986. I'm mm-hmm. walking out of a building I live in New York City.
Mm-hmm.
Two police officers are walking down the street. I hear them yell, take your hands out of your pockets and put them on your head.
Mm-hmm.
And there's an African-American kid in front of me. Mm-hmm. Puts his hands out of his pockets, puts them on his head.
Mm-hmm.
And then they start yelling, take your hands out of your pockets and put them on your head. I'm thinking, the kid's got his hands out of his pockets. And I turn around and I got the guns on me. Because it was a white guy in a leather jacket and robbed the store in the theater. Now, they threw me against the wall, did the whole thing. The kid stayed there.
Really?
And yeah. One of the cops turns to the kid and says, what are you still doing? He goes, I'm not leaving until you tell me I can leave.
Yeah.
And it was
mm-hmm.
just so.
The mental psychosis that happens.
Is.
And I think, again, right. looking at, delving into mental health a little, a lot of times, speaking as an African-American male, we don't speak about how we feel.
We're taught not to.
And yes, I'll agree with Lilani.
We're taught not to speak out in public or in mixed company or at home, even at home.
I would say at home.
A little bit of both.
The home, it varies. Yeah, okay, and that's and it's going to vary from person to person.
I just want to interject because the question that I was trying to get asked was, many white people have no idea what it's like to be black. Can you give, this is your opportunity to give some insight into exactly what you're talking about.
Well, I like Tom's story because I think it puts us in a mental psychosis of fearing the police particularly.
Yeah.
It's a conversation that unfortunately has to be had in the household. Whether it be, I've had law enforcement people who are African American who have to have that conversation. It doesn't make much sense. But again, it shows. And just even with this situation, obviously, going back to Charleston, it's very tough to verbalize in such a small segment how you really feel in regard to the legal system and not feeling protected by the league. That's where a lot of what we've seen within the last year is that African Americans particularly, but also other people, are questioning protection under the law. And if you don't feel protected, what type of feel is that for any person, let alone an American who claims that they're in a free society?
And you feel that here?
Yeah.
I'm not gonna say that here. I love my town.
Yeah.
I get along with people. I guess I'm somewhat biased because I've been here and just growing up here. And I think the diversity and the integration, the power angle, is one that is closer than most places. We've gotten a lot of emotional talk about diversity, about how people feel, but there's also the power angle. And when people feel powerless, we get back to disenfranchisement.
Mm.
We
right.
get back to people feeling hopeless. And that's kind of mixed into this big pot of things, of issues that
and
we're
kind
of doing. And
yeah.
the hate.
It's like, go ahead.
Jump
go
on
go
something
go
about
go
the powerlessness, because that resonates with me for another reason. I think that part of what fuels racism in this country is, a lot of people who, white folks who don't feel like they have any opportunity anymore,
those, yes.
and they're looking for somebody to blame.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And it's an easy out. And there's been a long history of blaming somebody else for the problems that you might have, and instead of looking at the larger picture of why society is like this.
Agreed.
And it's one of the things that we don't have in this country is opportunity, equality of opportunity.
Yes.
We could be equal under the law, but it doesn't matter if you're going to a terrible school.
Yeah.
Because you're never getting out of that.
You're not getting out of that.
You're not getting out of that
and
situation.
It doesn't discriminate. It's poverty.
Yes.
It's
poverty. Poverty.
Yes.
What you said, Tom, raises a big flag, red flag to me, which is that was how the Nazi Party came, or why the Nazi Party
right.
came to power in Germany in the 1920s.
Yeah.
So, are we at risk of that here?
Well, I want to get back to what you said about how do we solve this.
Mm-hmm.
And in, first of all, knowing all different people, that helps.
Yes.
In your law enforcement, having a diverse force,
that's
okay,
correct.
With
that's
women
correct.
And
yes,
all different ethnicities,
correct.
It helps. If
yes.
your coworker who, two officers would protect each other, through thick and thin, and your brother is... a black person or a Hispanic person
correct.
Or a Jewish person, you're going to understand that better than if you didn't know that person. That's
agreed.
How I think of it. I mean, Tom, do you disagree?
I
agree totally. I mean, I was fortunate enough to grow up in an area that was very mixed. Mm-hmm. And, you know, being a young man and my growing up with brothers, we got to know people through sports.
Yes.
Because if you could play ball, you could play, everybody liked you, and you know, you're going to hang out with people.
Yes. Leilani, is that a white person's view?
Huh. Oh, she's stinging me. All right, I want to hear it. I'm ready. Go ahead.
That's an interesting way of saying it.
Okay, that's a yes. Go ahead. Let's hear it.
I had my colleague ask me a question yesterday. She said, you know, how do you feel as a black person, you know, with cops? And I just said, I have cops that I know, family members who are cops. I have friends in my town in Mamaroneck. I grew up with some of them who are now on the force. And I said, I trust those that I know. And everybody else, I don't trust. It doesn't even matter the race. Because then you see like other towns or other places, some of these people who have been shot, killed, and everything are done by, like, even African Americans are killing, you know.
Killing each other.
So it's not, you know, when it comes down to the cops and feeling safe with, I don't trust. If I don't know you, I don't trust you. Okay. Just based upon what has happened in this country in the history of police brutality, police killing, you know, maybe, or even stop and frisk. It's you know, it is, I'm not taking away that it could be a race issue. I'm just not comfortable police officers.
I mean, I have a lot. I mean, there are obviously cops who shouldn't be cops.
Yes, correct.
Know, mm-hmm. Most cops, from my experience, are good guys who want to protect and serve. But mm-hmm. I think what happens with a lot of police departments, and probably doesn't happen here because it's a small community, is that they're so numbers driven.
That's correct. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it's about getting arrests down, giving tickets.
It's become a business.
It's right.
In regard to legality.
So, okay, I'm gonna give you a tidbit of information and ask you to interpret this. Okay.
Yes.
In Charleston County, South Carolina, when you're on a traffic stop, the officer, there's a box on the ticket for the race of the person who has stopped.
Wow.
How do you read that?
Wow.
I read that probably because it's a protection, and it was probably put in place so that, you know, a police officers down south couldn't stop 99% African Americans and get away with it.
So, yeah, legal defense in regard to some form of bias that might have been claimed before.
It might have been, I can't even imagine why that would have started, but maybe it was something to have a description of the person. I have no idea. But certainly we evolve and we reevaluate, and maybe something like that should be looked at.
So now let's talk about that Confederate flag. Should it be banned in South Carolina, and should it be banned in the country?
Well, the talk is that it's, you know, some people are saying that it should be banned, and some people are saying it really doesn't even matter, because then whether or not the flag is taken down, people still feel in their hearts of hearts that they still have that hate. So what is a flag? And yes, it's a representation of what the old South used to be, but if you still have hate in your heart, that flag don't mean nothing. It doesn't mean anything.
Well, I was interested to read that a bunch of retailers are actually not selling the flags now. So there can be a way to achieve good through boycott.
But I think we have to go backwards. I believe 2002, it was moved from the dome to the front. Okay, so what we see is the power of our legal system, the deals that are made, and it kind of goes into, I want to talk about that powerlessness. Okay, so now we've gotten back to what I call the original conversation of how people really feel within their communities. Are they being listened to? Are they have some form of power structure within that? So yeah, it could be moved again, but again, we could look at the political ramifications of moving something again, because there were political ramifications just to get it off the dome down to where it is.
So you're saying the people that wanted the flag up felt disenfranchised and angry that action was taken? Is that what you mean?
I'm just trying to, through the legal angle, which is the law of our land, look at a symbol that many people identify with, whether we write that or not, and many people don't identify with, and our course of action forward to try to get either that taken down or not taken down, but not through compromise of something else.
Okay, because again, we all, within that context of taking it off the dome, there were certain deals that were made that one of the guys was saying.
I was going more towards the First Amendment issue, is waving that flag like screaming fire in a crowded theater.
I think that when you say ban the flag, I don't think you can ban the flag.
I don't think you can either. You know,
right.
People have rights to be idiots.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know,
just say what you think, Tom.
But that flag, in my opinion, should not be on any governmental building in the United States of America.
Correct.
That is That's a flag correct. Of a group of people who were traitors, a group of people who fought a civil war against the lawfully elected government in the United States of America, and they lost the war. And that flag was then co-opted by the KKK, which is the original terrorist organization of the United States of America.
Agreed.
And it should not be on any governmental building. That is beyond the pale. And, you know, if somebody wants to, you know, what's his name? John Oliver said, you know, the good thing about the flag is it makes it easier to identify idiots.
Well, I would just like to point out that you two took opposing views of what people would expect, which I think is very, which is frankly very interesting. We're going to run out of time, but I actually wanted to hit on this issue that some people, I've read about this coming in as a mental health issue, and I read some of your media reports debating whether the 21-year-old man is deranged or merely a bigot with a gun. Christy.
Well, you can't do a hearing on that issue here, but you don't want to move away from the central issue of racism and that discussion and allow the conversation regarding mental illness to overshadow that other discussion.
Well, are they saying that hatred or racism is a mental illness? Or is it the shooting that's the mental, you know, mass shooting?
I don't think you can say racism is a mental illness.
I don't think so either.
But
we have a caller. I'm going to interrupt so we can get to our caller. Go ahead, caller.
Good job.
Caller, go ahead. You're on the air.
Yes, hi. So I have a question for the roundtable.
Go ahead.
And this is in regards to institutional racism in the village of Mamaroneck. So racism is so much more than individual prejudice or hate. There's also institutional racism. For example, in the village of Mamaroneck, institutional racism has been displayed through the narrow view of a Democratic trustee who views Latinos as those who merely perform manual labor, whom many can't vote, and therefore the Hispanic Resource Center, but not representation in our local government, should be enough for them. This same trustee also said in an interview in the Mamaroneck Review that the fact that we don't have a black trustee, does that mean they are not being served in any shape, form, or fashion? Absolutely not. It should be the same with Hispanics, end quote. So my question is for the roundtable. What do you think about this type of institutional racism and blatant disregard for the lack of minority representation in the village of Mamaroneck government?
Okay. Thank you, caller. I'm gonna break it down and let's take away the institutional racism and deal with the issue of, do you need to have representation of every minority for people to be represented? Christy,
Lolo,
go ahead.
I called you Lolo.
Okay.
You know what I think that says to me?
What?
When we talk about people feeling disenfranchised, correct, that person has a place that they can come and say, this is how I feel. Mm-hmm. And to me, that's the whole point.
That's it. Yes, correct.
So we may not agree with it. It might be a little off point for what we're discussing today, but that's what we want to allow.
Agreed.
Even if we don't like sometimes what the person says or what they are promoting, but we want to be in a place where we can talk about it, and maybe she has some valid points that need to be worked on. But that's how I interpret that kind of a comment.
I guess from what I'm hearing, she would like to have more of a different, like an array of ethnicities on the trustee board and, you know, village of Mamaroneck or town of Mamaroneck. Mm-hmm. And do I feel that I need to see
that's a good question.
Yes and no. I mean, but individuals have to step up and want to take on that job.
Yes. Would you vote for someone just because they were black?
did I vote for Obama because he was black? But he's half black, half white, so I
don't You're skirting the issue.
That's why I voted for him.
Right. So we both win. But what I have to look at a person's views and what they really stand for. If I was to run for a trustee, and hopefully I thought about running for mayor.
Come on, what are we hearing?
Mm-hmm. But, you know, I thought about it.
Now, Tom.
No, but. Tom, this is not a political
I'm outside of my political period.
Right. So, would you vote for somebody just based on their color, their skin, or their race, or whatever? It's great to see, it's good. It is a good thing when you see different ethnicities sitting before you, because then you have different views. Mm-hmm. The person you said on who asked the question in terms of
Hispanics, was the
question that you had in terms of goodness gracious, there
I go. Now I forget what the question
Lord
was.
Mercy. Well, no, it had to do with. What does it feel to be black?
Yes.
Right. You know, and that's a huge question. What does it mean to be Asian? What does it mean? How does it feel mm-hmm. to be Hispanic
female.
Or female or whatever? And to have a representation on a board is a great thing because not everybody knows. You don't know what it means to be black, but you know how it feels to be a female.
Well, when I was voted into office, my staff of women was very happy to have a girl on board
yes.
because I knew if they needed to take a break or something and it didn't have to be communicated in an embarrassing way.
Yes.
I got it. And so I would agree with you.
To side maybe with the caller, I don't know enough about the political system per mm-hmm. se to say who this individual is and to single out institutional. What I will say is, like Leilani said, there's nothing better than having a person who's experienced exactly what you're talking about to speak on your behalf. Mm-hmm. And in many cases, many people don't feel that way.
Yes.
Okay. So in the case of a school board, we can go political, but we can go just about anywhere.
Yeah.
You can go school board, mm-hmm. you can go political, you can go, you know, wherever you want with that kind of situation. What I would say is to mobilize people and make that happen. Okay, and I think there are people that are willing to mobilize within that community to make that a reality for them. You know, say that I can't really speak on specifics in regards to institutional racism because I don't know particularly the political makeup here.
I'm going to let you follow up, and it's going to have to be the
yeah,
end.
I just want to point out to answer the caller's question, the trustee who had said that, you know, apologized for it, and you know, an inartfully answered question does not mean it's institutional racism.
And on that note, we are going to have to wrap it up. I thank you so much
you
for
Tom.
Joining
thank
us.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes.
Pleasure
just,
to
yes.
meet you. Yes. Yes. Lovely. Congratulations on
your wedding. Nice meeting you, too. Nice meeting you.
Yes.
Mitchell. Oh, gosh.
You get the call.
I'm sorry.
Thank you. I'm feeling really
thank
good
you.
About it. We'll yes. be back really in a moment with more community stories.
On June 19th, LMCTV celebrated its 25th annual award show, recognizing the efforts of volunteers and their productions. Here is Kat Galliano with the story.
LMCTV relies 100% on their volunteers, and if it wasn't for them, we wouldn't be able to have our television programming. So tonight, we're here to honor their efforts.
Mike Witch hosted the Larchmont Mamaroneck Community Television's annual awards night at the VFW Recreation Center in Mamaroneck.
I'm Michael Witch, your host. No applause. I guess you were expecting Neil Patrick Harris.
Awards were distributed to the volunteers at LMCTV for their hard work and achievements.
Our first award is for the best videography for a community production, for the best series.
Best editor.
The best single program. Best new series on LMCTV.
Best news package.
Is the Marianne Sullivan Award. Volunteer of the Year.
Thanks for everything you've done. You guys are giving me an opportunity, and I'm just grateful.
I want to thank Christina and Dina and Matt Sullivan and everyone at LMC. You know, always pushing everyone to do their best, and can't ask for anything more than that.
Mayor Norman Rosenblum recognized LMCTV as a vital asset of the Mamaroneck and Larchmont communities.
LMCTV is the cornerstone that allows the democratic process to work in the Village of Mamaroneck. It allows people, you know, I joke all the time that the Village of Mamaroneck Board of Meetings are the best reality show in America. And there's a lot of truth behind any humor. And the fact of the matter is that's how a lot of people find out what's going on.
Eric Lewis, LMCTV's executive director, was there to praise our volunteers' hard work and to tell us what to look forward to in the future.
Our next step is to move into the firehouse. That's our next step, okay? We need a consolidated place. We need a place where we can hold more meetings, where we can do other kind of activities, theatrical works, filmmaking workshops, expand those, and the Soundshore Video Festival. We have to revive that. So we need a place where we can all be together.
We want to congratulate tonight's winners and also to invite the community to come and volunteer with us. I'm Kat Galliano for The Local Live. Meet Fergie. She's a spunky one-year-old Australian Shepherd Collie mix who loves people and other dogs. Our furry friend needs a home. For more information, contact New York Pet Rescue at www.ny-petrescue.org. It's been a pleasure, as always, to keep you updated with your community news. Don't forget to check out our website for more news and community programming at www.lmctv.org. And for internships and volunteer opportunities, please write us at thelocallive@lmctv.org. That's the news for today. I'm Marcella Milder. See you next week.
Tell us what you think. In person, over the phone, online. Watch and hear yourself on TV. You tell us, we air it. This is The Local Live.